Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time, for the afternoon, the opportunity to be in your sanctuary, to listen to you, to hear you speak to us, and also just witness these miracles that you do in our time, that somebody is blind but can read because of what you do and the encouragement that we receive from your word and the smile that we see on the face of Fiona. Lord, be with us as we share this time. We return all the glory and the honor to you because we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Brethren, I bring greetings from the Bible Society of Uganda, the board, and the staff. They are all aware that I'm sharing here from morning up to this afternoon. But we also bring thanks to you for the support that you've given Bible Society over the years. All saints here, thank you so much. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thanks for everything. You will see that as I explain through the worship here and the preaching. We want to thank you also for the building of a cathedral. There's a slogan I made here one time. I said, bigger or big cathedral, big Bible Society. And we have walked that journey. We're building a cathedral. We're building a Bible house. Because when you have a bigger cathedral, you have more people, and more people means more Bibles. So we want to thank God that we are growing together. But we also want to say, as Bible Society, we have joined you sometime back by providing a Bible like this. Anybody in the congregation who has this Bible? A Bible like this? It was marking 100 years of the cathedral here. Thank you. Thank you. At least I've seen one person. So we can clap for him. Thank you for keeping that Bible. And some of you have this Bible at home. When we produced these Bibles, we also did a special edition, limited edition, 100 of them, and we put your names on them and printed and gave those Bibles to you, and each one of you gave 1 million. And that money went to the cathedral. So we're here to say thank you for that giving. So that was 100 million. So when the cathedral is complete, Bible Society, we shall say we participated, didn't we? You know, somebody who gives you little money is the one who asks you for more accountability. When you see people asking you, give us the accountability, give us the accountability, you know they have not given much. But people who give you 100 million, who give you so much money, they give you and they trust you and they go and do other things. So when you see us claiming there that we've given some money, you know that is part of the reason. But as Bible Society, we also want to thank you for many of you as individuals, besides the cathedral, giving us money or putting a basket for us. You have decided to join us as members. Brethren, in 2013, I was looking for money because we wanted to change the face of Bible Society through resources, through money. And all of a sudden, and when I say all of a sudden, I mean it, my accountant called me and said, we have 100 million on our bank account. Now, before you think of the source, you first celebrate. You first say the Lord has answered the prayer. And friends, those of you who are here in the service, if your phone is on, if you had a sound which sounds like the bank, you know there are two sounds, huh? There is a sound where they are removing money from you. I don't want to see that one. But there is when they are doing what? Putting money. Beloved, if one sound came and like 100 million has come on your account, oh, however good the sermon could be, you would first walk out. You walk out a bit, and I tell people that sometimes the walking does what? Changes. You walk in a different way, either one. By the way, if you want to prove that, if one of us here has 100 million on the account, come and walk here, we shall know. Money you can't hide. And if you go outside there and you look properly at your phone, how much is this? 100 million. Wow, my money. It has not come by mistake. Then you will come back in here confidently. With that same walking, the new walking, and then you will ask the assistant provost, what projects are there now which we can fund? Because you have money. But brethren, when I got that money, the donors, we informed them, thank you. We sent an email and say there have been these projects that we are running. We want to spend this money in this way. Within less than 12 hours, another email came and said, no, we are soon coming to Uganda. We shall explain to you how to use the money. My heart went down. You've given us the money. Let us do what? Spend it. Don't give us instructions. Invited me a dolphin suit, left Bible House, 5 o'clock. I went there to meet them, three gentlemen, and they told me this. They said, we're giving you this money so that you support us on homosexuals and lesbians. The money is already on our account. And they added on another word that I rarely use, but today I have picked the courage. Your Archbishop is adamant. It was Archbishop Orombi at that time. But we have chosen you so that you can go through the different churches. And they added on another word, you will never lack money. Oh my goodness. Somebody who tells you you'll never what? Lack money. Oh, you look back at them and then you say there's something wrong here. But then I picked courage and I said no to that money. I said no very courageously, and one of them stood up. Brethren, we had prayed when we started. We had ordered for some juice. I was taking it. We had ordered lunch. I left it because I didn't have the lunch. Because they told me, if you are not going to do what we are saying, you must send our money back. My friends, comfortable, I said, let me go back to the office and send your money back. I left dolphin suits. It was past 5 o'clock. There was a jam. But sometimes when the Lord is saying, do something, you never care about those things. Don't start explaining. You see, there is a jam. You see, I will do tomorrow. You see, it is a Friday. It is called a procrastination. I beat that. Came back to the office. We sent back the money. The 100 million went back. I have said this in a number of places, and I know that there is evidence that 100 million came in and then did what? Went out. The way it came in. Brethren, I was 100 million less, but my heart was at peace. Brethren, there are things we can do without in our lives. They may sound good, they may look good, but you'll have peace. I went home, thought about it, and this is the lesson that has been for me throughout time. Poverty is bad. And let's do everything that we can that God may bless us. God may give us resources. God may give us money. And I like the words that Solomon says when he says, don't give me too much. But also don't give me too little. Just give me what I need. Brethren, that's my prayer that I pray as well. Give me what I need. There are certain things we don't need in life. Brethren, I'm telling you the truth. The things we don't need in life. And so I sat home, thought about it, and said, we must raise the money from where? I want you to say UG. Money from where? UG. It looked hard. I made a proposal, wonderful proposal. Those of you who have worked with me with the Bible Society, either on the board or wherever, you know I can do good proposals. Mr. Baingana, you know, I can do good proposals. I hadn't seen Madam. I can do good proposals. So I put the proposal before the board. And in the board, after you have read your proposal, we're going to have life membership. They will pay 1 million each. We shall give them a period of 12 months to pay that money. Brothers and sisters, board members, I think it is possible. The first hand came up and said, that is impossible. Now, you know in the board when somebody says like that, is there, like the person is kidding you. But what we read in the scriptures, nothing is impossible with God. So as I was reflecting on that and not arguing a lot, another one came on who made me breathe a little bit. Says, why don't we make it 500,000? And I started breathing. At least, from 1 million. While I was still breathing a little bit, Justice Ezekiel Mhanguzi, somebody that we know, president, he was a president of Bible Society at that time, he came up and said, brethren, this is a suggestion from the General Secretary. Let's allow him. Let's empower him. Let's watch him. It is not about us. It is about, brethren, they disowned me. But I came back to the staff and we fought hard to recruit life members. Wherever we went, and I am sure there are some people even from this cathedral who registered. January 2014 to December 2014, we had registered 100 life members of the Bible Society of Uganda. Fully paid. There is a chart I sometimes move with and I show people. These are the first 100 life members of the Bible Society of Uganda. Brethren, how much money is that? 100 million. A year before, we had sent back 100 million, which was giving me no peace. A year later, we have 100 million, which gives me peace. Beloved, I'm here to let you know, today we count 2,000 life members of the Bible Society of Uganda. And again, I ask a question. How much is that? This time you say, bah, 2 billion. Now, friends, if you have 2 billion, and a number of you have participated in the handwritten Bible, if you participated in the handwritten Bible, yes? By show of hand, a number of you. How much did you pay? 100,000. To write how many verses? One verse. Now, friends, do you know the verses in the Bible? 31,000 plus. Now, this is a proposal we put before the board, that if we write this Bible in handwriting, which we will actually launch at some point with our names at the back, we will have put together how much money? 3 billion. So if you talk of 3 billion and also talk of 2 billion, that is how much? 5 billion. Can't you build a Bible house? You can. And so last year, September, with some monies collected plus other sources I can't explain here in the sermon, we started the new Bible house. Today, as I speak to you, we are coming to completion. I have put a little details in the leaflet, but this is 8 floors. 8 floors for good business. And for us to complete quickly, we have left it as open space, just like you see this cathedral, so that somebody who comes to rent can partition. We are putting on the cladding. It has a face of an open Bible. When you look at it, it's like an open Bible. Friends, by God's grace, I have been to many, many, many Bible societies around the world. There is no Bible house like our Bible house. It is going to be unique. It is going to depict the image of God. But why am I sharing this? I also met another gentleman working in England. He came, he looked at our proposal, putting it as an open Bible, and he says, no, don't. And his reasoning was this. People who are not Christians will not rent on your building. He added on, Christians don't have money. Now, brethren, do you agree with him? No, no. But do you know what he was promising me? He was promising me, if you change that shape, we are going to give you a soft loan, $1 million. Brethren, I've gone through temptations. $1 million. Now, friends, $1 million is a lot of money. And it was going to give me a very powerful push. While I was still thinking about it, this time is when you rely on the board. One of my trustees said, you white man, the good thing, the gentleman was big in size, tall. I can't compare. But the good thing, my trustee was also tall and also. And I want to tell you where my trustee comes from. Kigezi. And my trustee stood up. I can give you the name. My trustee stood up and said, you man. He was pointing at the white man. Now me, I was trembling. I'm the one who had invited him. I'm the one who had, you man, in your place, you are pushing the Bible away. In our country, we are bringing the Bible here. Then he turned to me, Simon Peter, build a Bible house with a Bible face. And he went. That brother never gave me that money. But 2 weeks ago, I was in London, and I was showing him our building is getting completed. And he was thinking of coming. He hasn't confirmed. But I just want to thank God that he can believe in Uganda we can do something. And up to that level, all the money was collected from Uganda by Ugandans. Catherine and my team here, they have newsletters that can show you the names of the people. And some of those people are seated here. If you are a life member of Bible Society of Uganda, give me a hand. You know you have paid 1 million shillings. Put up your hand. Put up your hand. There are more people. There are more people. Now, brethren who are putting up your hands, this is the challenge of being a life member of Bible Society. You stand up. You stand up. Brethren, I want to say a big thank you to you, even as people clap for us again. And I want to request you humbly to keep standing. Just keep standing, my life member. Just keep standing. Keep standing. Because there are three or four things I want to tell you. Out of the money that you have given to Bible Society, a lot of the portion has gone to producing the Braille Bible, the miracle you have just seen happen here. And the reason I wanted you to know this, there are some people when you tell them, can you be a life member? They ask you, how do I benefit by being a life member? Brethren, isn't it a joy for you to be here and see a blind person read? Is it something you had ever thought about? No. That a blind girl from Kabale can come to Kampala, All Saints Cathedral, and take a what? A reading. Your money has done that. And while you're still standing, there is something that I've been demonstrating in the services. We have also partnered with organizations and brought what we call the Talking Bible. The what? Talking Bible. Doesn't it look like a Bible? It does. But it talks. Instead of reading, you do what? You hear it talk.
Zaliwa kwa Yesu Kristo, omwana wa Daudi, omwana wa Ibrahim.
Which language is that?
Yazala Isaka.
Kamahua kamalai, ganikaro ni wani matayo. Matayo, sula and wela.
Which language is that? Eh? Who is the mumasaba here? Me. Life members, keep standing, my brother. Don't sit down. Now, we have these talking Bibles in almost all our languages. Almost all our languages. So you link up with us, or better still, friends, go to your version, you'll be able to download. That's what we've done as Bible Society. Courtesy of you life members, plus the other monies that come to us. The Braille Bible I talked about is there in English, it is there in Luganda, it is there in Runyankore Ruchiga, it is there in Acholi, it is there in Lango. Where else should we go? Busoga, thank you, brother. Thank you for being courageous. But also remember Rumasava, eh? But that shows us the areas we are moving to, plus other many good things that we are doing as Bible Society. We have a project through your support of making sure that there is a Bible in every home, every hand, every heart, every hotel, and every hospital. There is even a staff fully in that. She was here in one of the services. But our slogan and our objective now is to make sure that there are three A's fulfilled. The Bible is available, it is accessible, and it is affordable. So every person who wants the Bible, they should what? Receive it. So brethren, don't come back and ask me, if I become a life member, what am I going to benefit? I don't have any other reasons for you. While my life members are standing, we give you one period of the year. You can actually start the payment today. You can start the payment next month or the time you choose. Pay in installments or pay at once. But we give you how many months? 12. But it's not cast on stone. The money could either come earlier or later, depending on how the Lord blesses you. Well, I have given a very big punishment to my life members. How many of you say we would want to join these people standing? I want to join them. Give me a card, and I want to join these people. And my people who are life members, please give the cards. Oh, you have one ready. Good. Get the cards to these people. When you get the card, then you can put down the hand. And my life members, now you can take your seats. Thank you so much. By the way, brethren, I go to the same church with the Bainganas. So when I share some things, I might refer to them so that the message comes home. Our topic talks about the living word. The living word being full of grace and power. The living word. And that draws us very quickly to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Hebrews 4, 12 says, for the word of God is active, is living, alive, living, and active, sharper than a double-edged sword. It cuts to the separating of the soul and the spirit, the bone and the marrow, and it also discerns the intents of our thoughts, our mind, and the heart. That's what the word of God does. living and active. So when we talk about God's word, we are talking about the word that takes action in our lives. We're talking about the word that changes situations in our lives. And so I came up with some three words that I would want us to look at. But before that, reading through Matthew 24:35, Mark 13:31, and Luke 21:33. What do those verses in the Bible say? They say one statement: heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass. Now, friends, it is a very difficult thing for us to understand that concept. We have been born on this planet. We see things on this earth. We walk on this planet. We see the sun rise. We see the sun come down. We see the heavens. And when you say heaven and earth will pass away, it can't come in this small brain of mine. I only read and I stop there. Heaven and earth will pass away. Friends, that's the truth. The investments we make, the monies we have, the resources we have, that scripture is telling us at one point they will come to an end. The things we believe in very strongly, the things we count as things that we hold on, at one point they will come to an end. And so I thought of three words to bring this sermon home. One of the words is blessing. And the other word is hope. And the third word is treasure. Looking at blessing, in Proverbs 10:22, the scripture speaks to us and says, the blessing of the Lord makes rich and it adds no sorrow. That's what God does with us. He gives us blessings, and the blessings he gives to us, they make us rich. They make us good. They don't add sorrow. We look at what God has done in our lives, reflecting on the two words, grace and power. For us, for me, for you to be alive today, it is the grace of God. Through COVID, brethren, how many people here, of course I know I might have a hand, but that would be a surprise. How many people here thought you would survive COVID? It was threatening. And indeed it was. We lost people. But brethren, let me tell you this. This time I can't even have a hand, but don't put up your hand. There are people who seated here, I'm telling you the truth, they never had COVID. Brethren, can you see what God can do? There are people seated here, they never had what? COVID. They interacted with other people. They were the super spreaders. One corner, then the other place. Sit down. No. But they were without COVID. Brethren, if you're here and you're like that, isn't that the grace of God? You shake people's hands, you do what? You reach home, they tell you the other person you shook the hands is where? He's on oxygen. We lost people. All of us, that one I can say all of us, we lost people. But that we are alive is indeed the grace of God. Now, brethren, as I talk about this blessing, let me make it a little softer. Because sometimes when you talk about COVID, somebody's like, don't mention that thing. The way COVID treated me, the way they did this, don't what? Mention. My parent, my wife, my husband, or whatever, don't mention it. Brethren, that's not what I'm not aiming at. But I want to tell you, friends, from the blessing that God has given us, it is good to have some money. That even through COVID, there are things you could do to try to save what? Life. We did things, and even English changed. You do steaming, and you also start, they say the word wisdom. And we drank things, and we did all sorts of things, because we want to survive. But brethren, when you're in the hospital and you don't have money, that's on my second point, which I'll touch shortly. Life can be hopeless. When you're in hospital in Mulago, whatever sickness, forget about COVID. If you don't have money, life can be what? Hopeless. But when you have money, caretakers are always there. Because there is some juice to take, they are always there. They actually exchange hands, This one comes, the other one says, I'm still around. And when you have money, more money does what? Comes. There is money on the account, but there's some money coming. There's mobile money coming. So the caretakers will be there. But brethren, you fall sick and you don't have money. The guys will abandon you in Mulago. You will keep just peeping on other beds for other people and looking and saying, hey, where are those people getting people coming from? Because you don't have money. Work hard. Hallelujah. Work hard. Have some money. The greatest gift, the people I'm looking here that we can give to our grandchildren, that we can give to our children, is to have something for medical even when we are old. On your account, have there some? Something. That's a blessing I'm talking about. It comes by the grace of God, but it comes through learning how to save. Save money, have someone on the account, even when they're struggling with your signature and whatever, you can give them the PIN numbers, I don't know what they call them. I can give them the whatever things to go and pick the what? The money. But you have the what? The money. Please don't leave it to them to run everywhere, left and right. So that blessing that God gives to you today, that you have breath, God has saved us from different situations, let's work hard. Blessings that God gives us, jobs, titles. I keep thinking about the provost when we come to our meetings. It takes me a mouthful to say her titles. The very reverend canon doctor. But you have to do it carefully because she's your supervisor. You must say it right. But just reflecting on my own life also, in 2009, they appointed me General Secretary, Bible Site of Uganda, General Secretary / CEO. Isn't it a good title? It is, it is. And then they said, you're going to be inaugurated. Your bishop must come from Bale. Seventh bishop from Bale, handing me seventh general secretary to the seventh archbishop. How does it feel? Woo, woo, like you're walking into heaven, eh? Seventh bishop handing you to the seventh archbishop and you are the seventh general secretary. That day, oh, I'll never forget it. I got home in the night and I whispered to my wife in a very nice way, by the way. These brethren know how I treat my wife. They do, they can agree. In a very nice way. Say, madam, from now onwards, you're going to refer to me as General Secretary. This beautiful child of God, after taking some breath, she looked at me and she said, you are my husband. General Secretary, where? But when you hear your word, brethren, from that day I left the title. So it's General Secretary. Let other people suffer with it. And I was telling people in the first two services, I'm rebranding. Brethren, call me SPM. It's enough, isn't it? Brother SPM, Simon Peter Muhammad. That's enough. Because I realized sooner than later, these guys are going to push me out. Now you find me on the streets and then start saying, the former General Secretary. When you meet me there, call me brother who? SP. It's more acceptable. But when you call me the former, it has its issues. Blessings. And in the note that I put here, said, count your blessings and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Many blessings in your life. Many blessings in our lives. Count those blessings and serve the Lord. Some of our homes, the children, the wife, the husband, the relationship is zero. The wife looks at the man like that man. And I was told this scenario where the man and the woman were quarreling and the man referred to the woman as, look at this goat. This is the man telling. And the woman also looked at him and said, look at this dog. And the children who were listening went and said, in that house, in that wall fence, a goat has married a dog. Husband and wife, relationship, zero. The children, you look at them, you can't believe it. Very bad relationship. But friends, when God blesses you, you find daddy calling mommy honey. Are there people like that? Instead of putting it in the tea, they call the human being what? Honey. Which other words, friends? I wish it was a youthful event. I would go into that. Sweetheart. But do we mean it? Yes, we mean it. Friends, it can be a smooth relationship between father and mother, parents and children. The blessing that God does what? Gives to us. Friends, the message I'm portraying to us, if your family is knit together, if your family is coordinating things very well, it is the grace of God. Don't go home and brag. You see our family, you see our this. But by the way, before I leave that point of blessing, I'm told, some people have researched it, it might be true, but let me find out from here, that in every family, there'll be somebody who is weird. Every family, however good, however nice, there is one person who is what? Now, the following statement is one which is dangerous. If you think there is nobody who is weird, it might be you. So if you say, us, our family, we are like this, we are a class, then it might be who? Well, friends, don't go back home and look for the weird person. This is for purpose of preaching. The other thing, brethren, the second point is hope. As we look at this living word, full of grace and power. That word brings to us hope. In the living word, there is what? Hope. We have hope. And if you read in Zechariah 12:10, he says that he will pour out his spirit on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. But he says that spirit, when he talks about of grace, it comes along with words like mercy. Mercy. But when God pours out his grace on us, what do we say? Have mercy on us. Because we don't deserve it. We don't deserve it. Have mercy on us. But there is a hope. There are situations that I've described earlier on which are hopeless. I am here to remind us, God brings what? Hope. So we must endure. We must believe. We must trust. We must continue waiting on him, knowing it is a matter of timing. We are people of a promise. There is a promise God has made in my life. There is a promise that God says, this is what you will be. Brethren, hold on it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hold on it. Hold on it. Hold on the promises of God. And friends, those of you who worship from this church, I think majority of you do. You have wonderful ministers here. Did you hear me? I know that you don't know. You have wonderful ministers here. Allow me to call them guys. The good thing I'm looking this way, for you to see their faces. These guys can pray. Somebody has cautioned me that I shouldn't say that. These servants of the Lord can do what? Can pray. Utilize that. Utilize that. Utilize that. Did you hear me? Utilize that. But the devil is a liar. He comes to kill our hope. One time in my home, I stay in Mutungo, we were going to host the guest, white. We prepared many, many, many things. You know that. By the way, those guys don't eat those things we prepare. You do a lot of beef, a lot of chicken, a lot of what? Then they come and just eat the bread they have finished. But as we're about the time to reach, by the way, they keep time. You say 1 p.m., they come at what? You wonder whether they were standing there and waiting. They come at that real time. But I still had a good minutes. I get into my car, Mutungo, some years back. I drove to Tichintale. What was I going to bring? Toothpicks. I remembered that there were no toothpicks. Toothpicks. I don't know whether the price is still the same, just about 500 shillings. But I drove the car, which is interesting. But when I entered the supermarket, I saw some nice serviettes. I saw some watermelon. I saw a pawpaw. I saw a few other things. I kept putting them in the basket. In fact, I remember the basket. I picked the basket. Put in the things. The bill was big. About 200,000. Paid back to Mutungo. Few minutes, the visitors came. After food, one asked, do you have toothpicks? No. I went to the supermarket and bought other things and left. Brethren, let me tell you this. Some of us, the reason we come to church here, you know it. We come to worship, isn't it? But when we get here, then other things, we leave the toothpicks. That reverend, he doesn't put on very well. But you see the way he prays. Is that what brought you? You leave the toothpicks?
You carry all the baggage, all the loot. You go home when you are loaded. But these guys, when they invite us, they say, come unto you, me, all you who are heavy laden. And I will do what? Rest. But we come here, we live here with burdens. Provost wasn't there. I'm not feeling very good. That there is a bishop. Actually, I would say the actual thing. You are bishop for Kampala, who is archbishop. When he was in Emitiana, or another diocese, I don't remember. The bishop he inherited was a fat bishop. Is that true? Could be Mutana or Mkono. There was a bishop. So when archbishop came in with a smaller size, people were like, you are not a bishop. You don't fill the seat. Eh? We need a you want a bishop who fills the seat, or you want a bishop who brings the message? Brethren here, you are blessed with servants here. You're blessed with wonderful servants. Servants who touch the heart of God. That you come to an overnight and you leave this place when you say, the Lord has healed me. The Lord has delivered me. The Lord has set me free. Brethren, why not hold on that hope? Jesus, I will hold on you. Jesus, I will walk in your ways. And finally, treasure this book. Hallelujah. Treasure this book. If you have your Bible, treasure your Bible. Read your Bible. Don't just keep it nicely, but do what? Open the pages, read the book. There are so many good things in here, and your life will change. I make sure every morning that I read my Bible. One of the things which challenges me, you are leading Bible Society, and you yourself, you are not reading. After some years, I thought even some of my staff might not be reading. So I asked them kindly by force, from January 1, this is what we shall read until this point. If I asked Catherine to come here, she would tell you the book we are reading with the staff. But wake up in the morning and read. Along that journey, January, February. By the way, some of the people surprised me. Some of the people I thought were reading. They told me the portions are too long. Friends, they can't be long. Remain there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They can't be long, but do what? Remain there. In March, one of the staff called me and said, I had struggled with my life. I struggled with challenges in life. But spending time in the Word of God, I'm seeing my life doing what? Changing. Woo! I'm seeing my life changing because of spending time in the Word. Brethren, as I speak to you, and I wish each one of us here had opportunity to stand here and look at the congregation. You look so nice. You look so humble. But it may not be the whole truth. Because we are in charge. Sometimes even in the inside of our hearts and lives, we are struggling with sin. Does somebody agree with me? Dressed smartly, coming to church, people know you as great, but inside of you there is what? Sin. And you're struggling. You're dying with it. And here in the church, we come and request you and say, come to Jesus. Come to the Savior. Find the Word so that you don't carry the burden, but allow him to carry the what? The burden. Don't struggle with sin. We are talking about grace where God takes place in your life and changes your situation. We're talking about holiness that does not come from you as an individual, but it comes from who? From God. But when I speak about treasuring the book, plus the three words that I have mentioned here, I'm sure we remember them very well. The first word is that this living word that is full of grace and power brings us blessings. Count them, look at them, you'll be a great person. And we're also saying this living word, when we look into it, there is hope. That I can look at the future and I say, I will make it. Even when people are telling me you can't make it, I see, I read the word, I say, I will what? Make it. And the third word I'm putting in here, I am saying treasure the book. Carry it well. Carry it as a treasure. Look at the words there. Look at the promises there. You will see your life change. Pray that may the good Lord bless you.